daybreak takes a break, but never takes a break. Some of the things that panelists say during the break, one day we put them on air, right?
Yeah, sure.
We should.
One day.
Let's now delve into the conversation of boundaries review, because these census results will be very critical when it comes to resources sharing to the various counties and obviously to the other constituencies. When the boundaries are reviewed, if you lose a constituency, then that means that the NGCDF that was coming to that area
disappears.
We're reduced because nobody will lose a constituency. Mm-hmm. You just may be moved. So when you look at these numbers, and having worked with the IEBC up to 2012, and you came up with the delimitation of boundaries that now allocated the 290 constituencies that we have currently, I mean, how much of shifts would you expect when it comes to regional share of constituencies?
In the next review? Mm-hmm. Well, in 2012, when the IBC, and by the way, I chaired the Boundaries Delimitation Committee of the Commission, mm-hmm. which was a whole committee comprising all the commissioners.
So if you're dissatisfied, we should blame you.
Yeah, I was the chairman of the Boundaries Delimitation, mm-hmm. and we went around the country to arrive at the 290. Mm-hmm. What we did, and I think it's the same, if you look at Article 89, it just says 290. The country is set at 290. That is what Article 89 has done. Mm-hmm. So we can't shift from 290. So divide by then the population in 2009, mm-hmm. Using the census, was 38.6. Mm-hmm. Divide by 290. Mm-hmm. So the quota then was around 133,000. Mm-hmm. And so the first thing was to divide Nairobi because it was the only city. So we said Nairobi, the population of Nairobi divided by, you know, the number of existing constituencies in Nairobi. Mm-hmm. And the quota for Nairobi arrived at 186,000. Mm-hmm. And Nairobi in 2012 had 8 constituencies. So we added 9 mm-hmm. now to make the current 17.
Right.
Then the rest of the country, then we minus the 17 from the 219, then we divided. Mm-hmm. And so that's how we arrive at the 290, with Coastal having 26, mm-hmm. Northeastern 18, mm-hmm. Eastern 44, like that.
Right.
So looking at the current population, mm-hmm. now, which has just been released at 47.6, divide that by 290 still. Mm-hmm. What is the quota? Mm-hmm. 164,000.
164,000, yes.
So automatically, you see, we are not, what Kenyans need to understand is that in the next review, and by the way, the Constitution talks about review within 8 to 12 years.
Right.
So 8 years falls in 2020. Mm-hmm. 12 years falls in 2024.
Right.
My take is that let's not touch boundaries. Mm-hmm. I keep saying this. Mm-hmm. Let us leave this issue of boundaries until after the next election, mm-hmm. because then we'll be able to do it in a fairly sober manner.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Let us not go, this boundary is too sensitive. It is too divisive. Mm-hmm. If we go this way, we'll have a lot of problems. For example, if we go at 163,000, which is now the current quota, mm-hmm. as defined in Article 89.12, then it means Lamu, which has 143,000, mm-hmm. will have to lose the two constituencies. They will only have one woman rep and the senator and governor, because they are at 143,000.
So we have one constituency.
Yeah.
They are 174.
They are 143,000. So they can't reach 164,000. Which is the national quota. So will Lamu really, will that be a fair way of doing
it? I think
things?
Lamu will still make a constituency, because from the quota, if you look at the city, which is Nairobi,
uh-huh.
you can go 40%, uh-huh. okay,
yeah,
up. And then for the rest of the country, 30%
down. You
know, so Lamu will still have one constituency.
Possibly.
So, Commissioner, but how soon after election would you advise for us to
I answer? Think, mm. because it is 2024, and election is 2022, if we embark on this thing around 2023, mm-hmm. we will still
so
be
give or take a year after yeah. election.
Because what it means is that unless we amend Article 89, mm-hmm. it means we are just going to look at readjusting who is going to lose, who is going to gain.
Right.
But let me
there is no increase. You know what Kenyans out there think is that the next review, I'm going to get constituency. Mm-hmm. That's what people are mm-hmm. thinking, that I may get a constituency. But the fact is, constituencies are locked mm-hmm. at 290.
And that doesn't grow.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this question, and Honorable Rosa can jump in on the responses. And so in 2012, you reviewed the boundaries based on 8 regions. Now we have 47 counties.
Yes.
Will you apply the formula based on regions or counties this time?
It's still the same. It must be applied through regions.
Can I say this?
I think that's the only way to arrive at. And by the way, talking about, and this is where the unfairness in the whole of Article 89, and I was discussing with her just a few minutes ago, it looks like at Article 89 7B, and allow me to read, it says, progressively work towards ensuring that the number of inhabitants in each constituency and ward is as nearly as possible equal to the population quota. So we are moving towards one man, one vote, as opposed to ensuring also the other criteria like geographical features, community of interest, means of communication are taken into account. So this constitution puts a lot of emphasis on population and population quota.
Can I
and
say
it would
this?
Be unfair to other regions, like now Notor.
Okay.
Can I say this as a member of the IIBRC, which actually worked on the modalities and of delimitation of boundaries before then we handed over to the, the new body. And he's rightfully said that this whole exercise is progressively moving towards one man, one vote. And that is why most of the emphasis is laid on population.
Okay.
The first criteria is on population, and that is why he's talking about the quota.
And therefore the question, will the formula apply based on the 8 regions or 47
counties?
So
what we did at that particular time, because of the word progressively, and we were starting at the bottom, we as a commission decided that we cannot take, we cannot jump straight to look at constituencies. We then decided to look at regions, hoping that the next review will now go back to counties. Then the next review will now progressively go to constituencies and then wards, such that by the end of all this exercise, after a few delimitation, a couple of years, each ward will have equal number of people as one ward will have equal number of people as the other ward. So all the wards should have equal numbers of people. All the constituencies should have equal numbers of people. All the counties, that is progressively. Okay? So what we
looked... That would be unfair to sparsely populated areas.
No, just
like
listen. Because the constitution changed. The constitution that we had before the 2010 constitution laid equal weight to the different parameters. But with the 2010 constitution, because of that fear and the clamor of, are you giving, is it votes or trees or people who matter? Representation, is it for people or stones or trees?
But can we strike that
changed.
Balance?
That was changed. And a lot of emphasis was put on a population. So the first criteria was on population. So before anything, you are measured on that population quota. Before any other consideration, you are measured on the population quota. If you fall short, you die. Whether you are vast, and you have poor infrastructure, you die. That is what this constitution means.
But Honorable Bashagwa,
So we went through the regions. We said, okay, and we look, the regions, by and large, what used to be the provinces. So we said that, let us look at the population. Kenya has 38 million, at that time, 38.6 million.
Right.
And it must have 290 constituencies. So we looked at central region, for example. What is your population? Our population is 4.3 million, for example. How many constituencies do you have? Look at western region. What is your population? Western region had 50,000, just less than central. How many constituencies do you have? So we saw that central region had 29 constituencies, despite the fact that it was 50,000, only 50,000 more than Western Region. Western Region had only 25. So we said, if they have 29 and you have 25, what are they supposed to have given the population in their region? And we saw that they should actually have 34. Then we said, so Central, you already have 29, meaning you've been enjoying undue benefit. So then we just give you 5 more or 6 more to get you to 34. Then Western, which had just 50,000 less, but were 5 constituencies lower than Central, we gave them 9 to get them to that level where they'd be 33. You know, so that the regions, by and large, when you look at the constituencies in each region, it's proportional to the population that each region has.
And
so now the next thing that these people are supposed to do, whoever is in IEBC now, what they're supposed to do is cascade this now down to the constituencies. When we got to the constituencies within a region, after we found how many constituencies a region ought to have had, now then we brought to play community interest, we brought to play geographical, whatever, we brought into play infrastructure, because the constitution does allow you to do that when you start looking at constituencies within that region.
But Honorable Gachagua, very interesting analogy there, but when you talk about that population being the basis of sharing out these constituencies, constituencies are also tools of, the resources follow constituencies, yes, when you're talking about CDF.
Yes.
So would it be fair for a county like Marsabit, which is very expansive, but the numbers do not work for it, yet you need it to be developed, yes, to have all the resources that they need, would it be fair to peg it heavily on population without taking regard to the geographical size?
Sam, representation and resources are about people. You represent people. You don't represent landmass or vastness.
But
or
when
trees,
those people are mass. Far apart, yes, they need
Let me say. When we get revenue collection, it is gotten from people. The more they are, the more they give. So when it comes to resources, the same people, the more they are, the more they are supposed to get. And I want to say this, let people not have a problem when people are more and they get more resources. I found a situation where, like my community, we are more in prison and nobody complains. And we are not in prison because we are thieves per se. We are in prison because we are more. Proportionally, this is a law of proportion. You know, when you go to the mortuary, we are more. When you go to hospital beds, we are more. Yet, people have a problem when we ask for more resources, and yet nobody is complaining when we are in prison. I think the law of proportionate reasoning is very important.
Okay.
Those who are more get more resources.
Okay.
Those who are more go to prison more. Those who are more go to the mortuary more, which is right, you know.
But
it's simple. And I'm saying, and we are saying ourselves, and madam here was whispering to me here at the press conference. We said, all these changes that are being proposed, we welcome them, provided they respect the principle of proportional representation.
Okay.
And one man, one vote. In fact, we are saying one man, one vote, one shilling. You know?
Okay.
Because some, my people, because they are more, they are giving more. Mm. They must get more.
No, no.
But I mean, it's only fair. It's only fair.
It doesn't work that way.
But yeah, it's only fair.
That's all fine. It should appear like rational comment. But how do you deal with that in a country that you have the case of marginalization, arid and semi-arid lands,
Yes, and that's where I come in here.
In a country that wants to ensure equality, even as you pursue equity.
Although the constitution in that article, and by the way, I think it was written by the people with more population, because then it didn't take the views of the people with less population, but with more land.
Mm-hmm.
If we follow the argument of my friend here, Regatti, it's a bit fallacious, because you can't say the more the population, we give more. What about Turkana, which is sparsely populated, give you oil?
Mm-hmm.
The crude oil is getting from Turkana with less population.
You're getting so 5% to use there.
That land is giving you more because it is bigger.
But
what about land with where we keep our animals and our tourists?
Mm-hmm.
It's giving more.
But this
even
debate,
though Lamu is
guys,
less populated.
You guys, let's not debate for fertility.
So I think
this debate is wrong.
Allow him to
finish. I think to me, to use the population as the only criteria is being used here will really disadvantage other people. We must use land mass.
Mm-hmm.
We must use the poverty index, because if we continue marginalizing these areas, and by the way, in 1963 after independence, the country had 117 constituencies, and now it has grown to 290.
So, Honorable Rigathi, just to pick your mind a bit further, if we went with the formula you're talking about, where there's more people, more resources is given to them, then what happens to the idea of devolution that we introduced?
No, devolution sorts out all this matter, because they'll get according to their weight, you know, and they are getting.
But Mandera would also complain the same thing, that devolution is meant to bring all these things to the common
No.
That whatever someone enjoys in Nairobi.
The whole idea of devolution brings equity, you know. You get what you deserve.
Can I say this?
And you also get what you also raise. I mean, we are talking about we must correct revenue.
Sam, can I bring
this? And that revenue must go back to the people who are
collecting the revenue. Let me say this as she comes.
Okay.
You know what we are debating now is null and void. Why am I saying that?
kilometers.
Because the constitution already indicates that population is the first and most, the criteria that we are going to use in delimitation.
Right.
This debate was there before this constitution was done.
Mm-hmm.
When, because in the previous constitution, all those criteria
parameters
were actually given, parameters were given equal weight. But with the change of the constitution in 2010,
mm-hmm.
the weight goes to population. So what we are talking about now is we need to therefore change the constitution to allow for these parameters to have equal weight.
Mm-hmm.
But what this constitution actually does, as much as it lays the first criteria as population, it then goes down to say that now as you go to look at your constituencies, you can now bring geographical features and urban centers, mm-hmm. community of interest, historical, economic, whatever, and means of communication.
Oh, right.
Now you can consider that, but you can only consider that
after
in an area population that has actually qualified
okay.
and met the population.
Sam,
Sam,
I want to totally disagree mm-hmm. with the Honorable Gachagua. Because when you say population, really, yeah, and that's why at the beginning I said, let's also, it was good we consider the geographical size,
mm-hmm.
the poverty index,
mm-hmm.
and also the development. Because, let me say, in terms of service
you
delivery.
You would consider at the point of delimitation yeah. or sharing revenue to the counties?
All, even sharing the revenue allocation for the, yeah, even all. Because this census, revenue allocation is a very crucial. And you cannot, you know, allocate revenue or resource based on population, really. Let's
sure.
say, comes to the service delivery. You, people, I can, let me speak for Wajir.
Mm-hmm.
People look, get services as far as 120 kilometer, 80 kilometers from where they are.
Mm-hmm.
Hospitals are there, schools, you know, all services. Let me say, someone who lives from Mandera, the farthest end of Mandera to Mandera town, that is almost 120 kilometers.
Mm.
So you can't tell me those are people who are living there.
Okay.
You see, development-wise,
but
gone.
Yeah.
But you can't subject those people to population.
In terms of resources, we agree with you. We're having an issue here.
Yeah. Yes.
Like we have constituencies.
And let us be sensitive to everybody.
We get 100 million per constituency,
right,
irrespective of the population size.
Mm-hmm.
We are having constituencies in northeastern Kenya with a very low population.
Mm-hmm.
They are able to give bursary to everybody, even sponsor children to go out of the country.
Mm-hmm.
In my place, it is tickling because of the population size. And we are saying, how do you give somebody
mm-hmm.
with three times the population size a similar amount? Is there fairness? Is there equity?
Okay.
And I think
and these resources are about people.
Okay.
Sam, they are not, you don't spend them on trees or
the equity comes in.
And to save what the constitution did, because
yes.
the constitution laid more all the emphasis on population, disregarding what Honorable Gedi is talking about.
Mm-hmm.
But then they introduced equalization fund.
Okay.
Equalization fund, which is supposed to give an edge to areas that are vast, to areas that have poor infrastructure, like what she's talking about with Northeastern.
Mm-hmm.
So those would be the areas that actually benefit from equalization fund in an attempt to try to correct that issue
equalization.
Allow me to say this first. Mm-hmm. When you look at how the formula of 2012 was done, after you share how many constituencies should go to which region, then the parameters or the population quota, like he was alluding, would change based on those calculations. For this year, 47.6 million Kenyans, then for cities like Nairobi, a constituency would have a quota of 229,000 people. For other areas, it would be 30% greater, there is a population quota of 213,000. For other areas, they will be allowed 30% less than the population quota, up to 114,000. For sparsely populated areas, that might go to 94,000. That answers the question regarding Gachagua saying that certain constituencies may be there, but with fewer numbers. Then I wanted to touch on the resource sharing. Currently, the formula that the Commission on Revenue Allocation is using gives weight to the population at about at 45%. Then for equal share of revenue goes to at 26%. Then there is 18% based on the poverty index. Then the land mass that will take care of the geographical location or geographical area is 8%, and 2% allocated based on fiscal effort, and 1% based on development factor. Of course, there is a recommended a new formula by CRA. I believe it's stuck at the Senate
that
reorganizes how it's shared, but still gives weight to population to up to 45%. I'll just take a look at the feedback that you've been sharing on Twitter, as well as on SMS, so that we can wind up on this conversation. If you can have what they're saying at Citizen TV Kenya, hashtag being Debrek. This is Carlo Leparillo. I do not agree with the Census 2019 data that was released yesterday. The methods used were erroneous and not accurate. Too much discrepancies. KNBS has failed us. I wish you could tell us how.
Okay. Still on Twitter, Captain Jirage, good morning. You say it's time we reduced the political representatives. We cannot have Ruiru and Juja constituencies like over 300,000 people each, whereas a county like Samburu has less than 310,000 people with three constituencies. We need to borrow from the Congress.
Well, it's not true that it has less than 310. It actually has 310,327 people. Captain Jirage, you said that it's time. Just hold on. It's... Oh, Kennedy Atinda, you said that our political class are blinded with the numbers for political bargaining, not genuinely for estimation for development planning. Least unit of measurement is always attached to any gadget.
Okay. Mohammed, good morning. You say censors are guidelines to resource allocations for equity. The manner it's conducted is as unequitable as it gets. Factors are not considered for correct results, but to beat deadlines. This should be an ongoing process, and we have 10 years to get the next one right.
Of course, still questioning the validity of Census 2019 results. Mutembei Wankone from Meru. I totally support the census exercise and concur with the results. I'm proud that I fully took part in the exercise. The figures will help the government for budget and planning for the national, for the nation. I beg politicians and critics to hold their horses and give credit where due.
Do they have horses?
Catherine on SMS, good morning. You see, some of us, we have not been paid. It is so unfortunate that they are showing us their work we did, and the token, as they used to call it, has not been seen in our pockets.
Well, that's interesting, because I saw a statement coming from the Kenya National Bureau of Statistics that was talking about how the payment will be done.
For
there are certain bank accounts that are in question. They're being investigated for the payment to be done to the clerks. Comment from Eldred?
Comment from Eldred. It says many Kenyans ignore the pleas from the politicians to travel to their home constituencies for the census. That's why these politicians are now crying foul. The results by any standards seem accurate. Politicians who stick to their politics and allow professionals to deal with the real statistics.
Well, but you see, oh, there's another one. Muhyiddin from Moyale, Marsabit. With this population explosion, one wonders whether our shrinking economy can sustain the basic essential services. If anything, it will perpetuate poverty and factorize tyranny of numbers. It's time we revert to birth controls.
Wow.
Really?
Wow.
But I thought more population, more manpower.
Mary from Narok. To me, population statistics in particular county is just an assumption, not realistic, since the issue to do with students, employees, and more others have to move away from the origin homeland due to unaffordable circumstances. For clear counting, people need to be counted at their respective counties.
All right.
The issue of rural and urban migration.
So that's what Kenyans are saying. I just wanted to read a statement that came from the KNBS yesterday on reasons for non-payment. This is for the benefit of people who worked with the KNBS. Between 24th of August and 31st during the census exercise, wrong personnel details is one of the reasons, KRA PIN and bank account. Second is loss or damage of tablets, power banks, and solar chargers or accessories. A committee is reviewing the circumstances of loss or damage to determine personal liability. This involves going through Form C, which was being filed when a loss or damage occurred. And then there's inactive or dormant bank account. The account details are also being verified. The remaining four counties will be cleared by the end of this week. So there are some four counties that are yet to be paid. So those are some of the reasons that are been coming from the KNBS. I wish we had more time to continue this conversation, but thank you so much, Thomas Letangulia, former commissioner of the IEBC.
Can you give us a closing remark?
Yes, unfortunately, I'm totally out of time. Fatuma Gedi, of course, you have to give Kenyans an opportunity to say something. Fatuma Gedi, woman representative for Wajir. Rigathi Gachagua, member of parliament for Mathira constituency, and Rosa Buyu from Kisumu County. Thank you all for making time for us.
Thank you.
Up next is.
Willis Raburu, who will be talking to Crazy Kenaro on this Beyond Committee, this being a Tuesday. We can't wait to see what is his all have for us in store.
Imagine after such a conversation, we'll talk about someone who's crazy.
Wow, it's the act. Oh, it's the comedy name behind it. See you in a bit.